Batman!
You did it too fast. No, I'm good.
Bang! Zoom! Zip!
Kerplutch.
Kerplum!
There was so many new fun onomatopoeia in this one. Oh my god.
Oh man, it was hilarious. What is going on, people? This is Elder Tenshi, and today on the panel I got my cousin Rick with me once again.
Five times, right? Where's my jacket?
We are about to give you your official... Oh, sorry, we can't afford that, so you know what I'm going to give you? You know what? I'm going to give you a bag of chips and a cookie. How about that?
Awesome. All right. Chips Ahoy, please.
Yeah, cool. All right. So, oh, man. So, what's going on, people? For this episode of On the Brain, we're going to be talking about the latest Batman animated movie from DC and Warner Brothers, Batman versus Two-Face.
Can I just say it's a little funny that we're talking about an animated Batman movie when we were just talking about how there's too much of it?
Which, like, I would recommend you guys listen to. Is there too much Batman in the fandom? Let us know. Our podcast we recently did was Too Much Batman, just talking about how Batman's getting too much of the spotlight when it comes to animated films and comics and so on and so on.
Oversaturation, baturation situation.
But, exactly. But for this time, we decided to put our fist down and just enjoy going back to the 60s and hearing the voices of Adam West.
Rest in peace.
Julie Newmar. And
still alive.
And... Catwoman for life, and what'd you call it? William Shatner as
Hanging
Two-Face.
Hanging on by a thread.
Oh man. I'm gonna be 100% honest with you. The first time I heard the voice for Two-Face for this version, and I didn't know it was William Shatner at the time. I'm just looking at the trailer. I'm like, is that William Shatner? It sounds just like William Shatner. Lo and behold, it was. And when he comes out with that Two-Face voice, like, okay. He put some work in it.
He's acting. He's actually acting, not doing that Shatner staccato that people have come to love and make fun of, like I am currently.
But he actually did that during the Harvey Dent scenes. There was some roboticism to his voice, but it was still smooth.
Yeah,
like he still had that William Shatner.
It was Captain Kirk smooth Shatner.
Exactly. they didn't even like because they're voicing, you know, characters that Two-Face was never in the 1960s show.
He was deemed too scary.
Too scary. But I went on record saying with my friends, if they did do it back in the day, Clint Eastwood would probably be my first choice.
No, I feel like Shatner would have killed it back then.
You think Shatner would have killed it?
Yeah. Oh yeah. Clint Eastwood, I feel like, was he a thing in the 60s? Yeah, I feel like he didn't come along till the 70s.
When did Dirty Harry come out?
Late 70s, early 80s.
Mm.
So yeah, like, keep in mind, this was Star Trek had been off the air. I feel like Star Trek had been off the air by the time this show came about. So, I mean, Shatner was still, you know, acting out there, you know?
Yeah, but that would have been cool to see him on screen. But you know what? Because it's animated and because it's years later, they could do more than what they could have done with their limitations back in the 60s on campy television.
Yes.
And make no mistake, if you haven't seen the Batman animated show...
Why are you listening to this?
If you haven't seen the Batman live-action 60s show, even if you've never read the comics, one piece of Bat history... The cheese, the campiness of the 1960s
Indeed.
Show. It's there. All of it.
It's beautiful. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing.
What was the movie before this one?
Okay, the previous one was called Batman 66, Return of the Caped Crusaders. Like, don't quote me on the 66 part. I just know it was Batman, Return of the Caped Crusaders. And I feel like... It was the proper sequel to the Batman movie from then that featured, you know, all the main villains. Something you really can't do nowadays with a superhero movie like that. And, God, it was just some beautiful camp. And it features, there's one part in it where Batwoman uses something called Batnip on Batman. And then somewhere, like I said, it's been a while since I've seen it, so I'm just, you know, I'm paraphrasing a lot here.
Yeah, go right ahead.
Where it was, at one point, Batman, he gets rid of all the villains and uses a replicator ray on himself and, you know, we didn't give a spoiler warning at the beginning of this, so we might have to go back, whatever. And so the Batnip over time is turning Bruce into, like, a real dick. Like, penis, not like Dick Grayson. He ends up, like, Robin questions him about something, and he kicks Robin out the house. And like I was saying, he becomes disillusioned with the government in Gotham, and then ends up taking over the police, using the replicator ray to become, like, create a bunch of other Batman, and takes over the police force and all this other just beautiful, beautiful campy goodness. Like, there's a scene in it where it's just so funny to me when I think about it. Where they try to give Batman an antidote to the Batnip, but he anticipated this, so he already had an anti-antidote. Like, oh God, it's just beautiful.
It's camp. Just beautiful
camp. I don't want to go into any more of that because it's not what we're here to talk about.
It's just beautiful camp. But I wanted to use
that. And you that. Haven't seen it either, so I'm not going to, you know.
I wanted to use that to set this up because in Batman versus Two-Face, it's the beautiful camping, the beautiful campiness. It's the colors. It's the clothes.
It's the word balloons.
It's the word balloons, the onomatopoeias, everything that you remember from the 1960 series, even if you were not a fan, someone knows about that series. It's no question about
that. And for a lot of people, it's people's first Batman.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, unless there's an 80-year-old out there that remembers the serials from, what, the 20s and 30s? Like, yeah, I remember that was my Batman.
Yeah.
Hey. Or from the 40s, I mean, because Batman didn't exist till 30 something.
Right, but that would be so dope. But this is basically, this universe is... version and origin of Two-Face.
Yeah.
Well, I should say, I would say origin, but just know that there's going to be a giant spoiler warning throughout this entire review. Because I feel like we can't really talk about it without spoiling it. That's the thing. So if anybody feels they don't want to be spoiled, then I totally understand. But anyway, so I would say origin story. But no, it was more like
one.
It was more like an origin scene, and then that's it. So, okay, so
set the stage, Kyle.
All right, so starts off with Batman and Robin having to go to this demonstration by the Doctor
Hugo Strange,
and he has this machine that he claims will extract all the evil from Batman from. From
the villains.
Gotham's the villains of Gotham. So they do it in this huge laboratory, this room with this huge machine, and they look like hair dryers. Like
it should be noted too that Harvey Dent is there because he prosecuted a lot of these guys and put them in behind bars.
Right. They've already established that Bruce Wayne and him are friends. At the beginning, it didn't really seem like Harvey didn't back and Batman got along very well. I think he was very condescending to him.
A little bit, but
You know? But then
keep in mind though, a lot of lawmakers in Gotham, they're like, well, we don't need the bat. We can do it ourselves until somebody throws a bomb in City Hall, like, where's Batman?
Exactly. So I found it kind of typical in a way that all it takes is some science goo to get on your face and then it instantly changes you. And not only does it instantly change you, but you already have a name and motive.
Look.
Like, you knew this was going to happen.
Like, I feel, too, like this is the first real kind of attempt at an origin scene in, like, the entire series. Like, maybe even the 60s one. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's been a while since I've watched that show, but I don't think they were too big on origin stories. You know, well, actually, like I said, it shouldn't even be an origin story. It's an origin scene in this. Like, he gets the gas or whatever it was on his face.
And they ask and him, then, Harvey, are you okay?
And he's like, no, I'm not Harvey. I'm Two-Face.
I'm not Harvey. I'm evil incarnate. I'm Two-Face.
To which me and Kyle both hung our heads like,
really? Really? And then they skip ahead months later.
Well, so, I note too that the montage in the beginning, like the, they like during the credit, the opening credits, is pretty much, I guess, the six intervening months from there to when suddenly he has a one face again.
Right, because Batman pays for him to have reconstructive.
Bruce Wayne.
Bruce Wayne. Excuse me, pays for him to have reconstruction surgery on his face. And we wake up to see regular Harvey Dent, and I'm like, okay, so...
I called him One Face.
Like, what the heck? Like, what the heck happened to Two Face? And then we get this plot with King Tut. And... So King Tut's a villain that has a split personality that every time he gets bumped on the head, he turns...
He thinks he's the reincarnated...
The reincarnated King Tut.
King Tut, yeah.
And we were bad during that scene.
Because it was
We were bad during that scene. We know what era this is supposed to represent. We know exactly what they're doing here. There's no offense to this, but I just was like hanging. Part of me was like just hanging my head in shame.
Well, because like I said, it's beautiful camp, but sometimes you just can't be like. You try to suspend disbelief, but sometimes you're just like, come on.
You try to forgive them for the era in which this is supposed to be depicting. So part of me was like, oh, really? Really? I mean, they gave a pretty decent explanation. I mean, he thinks he's King Tut. His first personality is a professor of Egyptology.
No, that's his actual personality.
Well,
professor
his actual
McElroy.
Yeah. So as the professor, he is a an expert on Egyptology. He studies this stuff. So of course he's gonna think he's King Tut.
Well, yeah, you immerse yourself in something enough, then you know you get a hit on the head.
And you get on a hit on the head, which is as simple as that. I mean, just a hit on the head.
I mean, if that's the case, then I should have been Batman several times.
Dude.
As much as I know, I mean, every other hit on the head should have turned me into a different superhero.
Then I would have been a Ninja Turtle. I would have been a Power Ranger. I would have been Steve Urkel. Give me
Then you could have created the machine to make yourself Stefan Urkel. Or whatever person you wanted to become, as long as you had some of their hair. That was a plot point in later years. Like, off topic, I just remember him putting like Bruce Lee's hair in his machine and suddenly he could fight. Anyway, off topic.
Yeah. I'm just saying, if that's all it takes for your personality change, and they even bring up the cops like trying to get him to confess to his misdeeds.
And it was some nice 60s assault.
Yeah.
By a man in blue.
Because if a cop hits you with a billy club as you're sitting down, that would be considered assault, wouldn't it?
Yes.
But no, because it's campy, cartoony Batman, they're trading the billy club back and forth like,
every time Chief O'Hara hit him on the head to get information out of King Tut, King Tut took and was like, you're not getting my information. Donk. This went on for like four or five times each. Or
I felt so bad for him for a minute.
Like, he comes out like, why is my head hurt? Why don't I remember what the color red smells like?
But it's it's just so delightfully campy with the henchmen and everything. Like,
yeah, and it was like certain things were a little bit predictable too, like how everything like you could tell that Two-Face was still behind the scenes, but you didn't really know how. Like, it was a very nice reveal later in the movie.
Well, yeah, mm-hmm. I will say that.
Yeah, it was like he had other, what was the other one, Bookworm, another villain that was very lesser known.
Yeah, very obscure. I gotta give him credit for that. There is this scene where they're fighting Bookworm because they're convinced that he's behind this, you know, that he's behind this theft.
Because the books are, you know, the library thing, so.
Exactly. And they get into this fight with all his henchmen who happen to be wearing glasses, and Batman's like, glasses.
No, I won't hit a man with glasses.
Not hitting a man with glasses. So everybody removes their glasses, puts them in this collective box from this mute henchwoman, and it just goes on from there. And then we see more onomatopoeia.
It was beautiful. Like, Blorg? Was that the Blorg? One word? Like, those words, like, I feel like they made up just for this because you can only do pow, kapow, zap, sock so Zoom. Much. Because yeah. Wasn't it blur for one of them? Like
there was kablam for a couple of them. There was kabloom. There was tries.
Zork.
I'm like, were they getting their dialogue from? Were they getting their onomatopoeia from Pinky and the Brain? Because that's what it seemed like to me. Because
they were just like, but like I said, they could only use those other ones. They had to create new ones, and I'm glad they did. Whoever yeah. was in charge of that deserves a
look,
medal of some.
All of this was just so it was so beautifully done, but we haven't even talked about
to the meat of the story.
Yeah, really yet. But before we do that, I gotta give it up to everybody involved in this project because Julie Newmar returning as Catwoman. And also who returned as a cameo?
Okay, there was a assistant DA by mm-hmm. the name of Diamond in it, who was voiced by the other Catwoman, Lee mm-hmm. Merriweather.
Lee Merriweather.
Who I was like, oh wow, she's still alive too.
Right.
And there was a scene, and I just loved like how they kind of played around with it, because there's a scene in it where this DA goes to Catwoman. Because a cat had gotten in, her cat had gotten into wherever she was locked down, and then the cat, you know, she's like, is this a friend of yours? And then, yeah, the cat suddenly becomes mean and slices the woman because the cat's claws are toxic somehow. And then Catwoman apparently can use her claws because, oh, they let her keep her costume
while yeah, she was they buying let her keep bars. Her costume, heels and all, ears and all.
And like, suddenly, like, she can just, instead of, you know, wait until maybe not the guard's not around to do this, she waits for somebody to replace her. And so she just uses her claws and, you know, unlocks it. But then this is the neat little kind of acknowledgement Easter egg. Yeah. Yeah, like she trades places with the character being voiced by Lee Merriweather and puts her in her full Catwoman garb. So it's like, oh, okay, I see what you're doing there. And she even says that it looks perfect. And I was
she's checking herself out yeah. in the mirror, and we're checking her out a little bit.
like it was a nice little throwback mm-hmm. Easter egg for the most part.
It was beautiful. But can we we already know that Batman, especially in this version, had a lot of sexual tension with Catwoman, and they didn't stray away from that not one bit.
They're kind of dating.
They're kind like, of dating while see, she's still in jail.
Yeah, like when you first see Batman, he's like talking to her like, oh, I brought this book. And we're gonna whatever. Yeah. And then like they're talking back and forth, and the reveal is that she's behind bars still.
Mm-hmm.
And well, I can't say full costume because she didn't have her mask. Have her mask on really in this movie at all.
Like we didn't even know. I knew she had the ears, but the full costume kind of threw me off for a minute.
Hey, wherever they were locking them up in, it was.
Everybody has their skills.
Yes, so, but I don't know, because when they brought in the Joker and all those other ones for Hugo's thing, they were in like.
They were in prison suits.
Yeah.
So, Catwoman. They
maybe
because
she
got the cat suit. She still got the ears.
Maybe
still got the claws.
She was the only female villain in town. Because I mean,
the
they really
entirety
had
the, of the. I mean, there was a Harley Quinn nod.
Yeah, and, but I mean, it was nice to see like characters that weren't even a thing. Like, well, I guess for the most part, Harley Quinn like wasn't even a thought when that series came out.
Nah, cause she didn't show. She didn't show up until the 90s.
30 years later,
show.
Damn near 30 years later. Yeah.
Yeah, but now she's in the Batman 66 comics.
Ew, I am so behind on those comics.
I haven't read any. I've just seen some panels here and there, and I know that she a version of her is in there.
Well, I mean, I'm not surprised because every version of Batman that they've done since. Has incorporated some version of a Harley Quinn.
Right.
Like, even the Brave and the Bold version of Harley, like, that had that Harley Quinn, but that Harley Quinn was more like a gangster's girlfriend. Like,
yeah.
Oh, Mr. G. Like, even more, like, you know how her voice is already kind of gangster's girl, and like, even then, because she looked like a 30s flapper, she's like, oh, Mr. J, 23 Skidoo, other type shit.
But, Okay.
But you can't do it, like, ever since, like, you can't have anything. And I'm glad that they, like, granted she was only the doctor, she didn't become Harley Quinn at all. And right. It was just nice to see a little nod.
Right, exactly. Including the voice.
Yeah. Yeah. The voice was, yeah, and it was appropriate for the time period, too.
Right, exactly. And so Harvey Dent is shown throughout most of this movie. And then, but you still hear remnants of Two-Face. So I'm thinking to myself, did they split them in half? You know,
I was thinking that maybe it was a old switcheroo. Like he got somebody that looked like him enough.
That was another theory I was thinking of.
Like, and then because there's that scene on the phone where he's like Harvey Dent is talking to Two-Face. So I'm like. Okay, wait a minute. What's going on here?
Because they made it seem like he was actually talking to him over the phone. So I'm thinking, did he have somebody else disguise him and take his place?
Yeah.
You know? But then when you find out exactly what it is and what they do with the character, I'm like, okay. This is exactly what I think they would do for this particular character, because
it becomes very Jekyll and Hyde.
Very much so.
Exactly Jekyll and Hyde for the most part.
Yep.
Because I mean, we're going, like I said, this is going to be spoiler filled.
Spoiler heavy. But
there's a scene where Robin from the jump doesn't really trust Harvey Dent,
and because him and Bruce are so close. Yeah. Bruce has to, you know, has to tell him. I think that your paranoia, your Dick Grayson paranoia, is clouding your judgment. And I think your Bruce Wayne friendship with Harvey Dent is clouding your judgment. And he's like, I haven't had to say this in a long time, but go to your room.
He sends Gladly. Robin to his room. Like, okay, that's a thing, but yeah. And then Robin goes out and follows Harvey Dent to wherever it was, a warehouse or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then Robin confronts him and he's like, no, you shouldn't be here. And then Robin gets knocked out from behind. And
they experiment on him. Yeah.
Two-Face is there suddenly. And then it was a scene very reminiscent of the Joker scene from Return of the Joker, the Batman Beyond movie.
Oh, word.
Where the Joker tries to, well, he succeeds in making the third, was it, my God. Tim Drake, a Joker.
Oh, kid, yeah, remember? Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like, I got kind of a vibe like that. Cause, I mean, they both succeeded and both, you know, Robin becomes Robin Face.
And I found that really because okay, now you have not just, but before there was Joker toxin, now you have like this Two-Face toxin, because it's filled with everybody's evil essence. So apparently evil essence turns you into a split personality.
Yeah, like I was saying the whole time, whenever somebody got sprayed, oh, it's woman face, it's this one, I had to stop at blackface because Kyle.
Oh no!
It was a black guy,
because there was one black guy throughout this entire film,
and he became
a Two-Face himself, because the plan is to spread the toxin around the city and turn everyone into Two-Faces. Something
faces.
So, and I'm glad they didn't give each other names, but we're just sitting there.
No, it was just a fun thing I was doing, because I was just like, wow, it's me, Ladyface. It's me, Kidface. It's me. Not gonna say.
Not gonna say.
It's okay. Like, I can make that joke. I have black friends. I'm glad that you got that, because
I know,
being a person of color, uh-huh, said color that I just said, I've said that joke to people before,
and threw them off.
You have black relatives. I'm like, right over your head by a mile. But yeah, oh yeah. So it's like, wait, where are we going? We kind of lost track with the whole.
Okay, so.
No, I lost track.
Yeah, no, it's fine. So along with the campiness, it is impossible for people to actually get hurt in this. While you do see, you know, the punches, the whacks, the bams, the kicks, the slams, all that stuff, nobody gets seriously hurt. And if they do, you don't really see it.
Well, so, yeah, because I mean, there's only. Keep in mind, this is still for kids for the most part, and I mean, fans of, but you know, it's at the end of the day, it's a cartoon.
Yeah, this is, well, Yeah, but at the end of the day, so was the live-action 66 Batman. That was a live-action cartoon. Nobody got hurt in that one either. Yeah. They had explosives. They had weapons for every occasion.
And well, this that one Batman had, was the one that had whatever he needed ever, on him whenever.
Ever. If you're getting attacked on a if you're getting attacked on a rooftop of a bus and you call Batman, just have him bring out the bat net with an autopilot on the Batmobile. Which, by the way, the Batmobile looks awesome in CG. And yeah, you're safe.
That's just how it is in 66 Gotham.
66 Gotham.
A lot of women catching the vapors on that bus as soon as they see villains, like, oh my word, I never.
And as soon as they see Batman, they're like,
ooh, Batman.
It was beautiful, but the story did get kind of dark. Like they did reference you know, the dark shadowy Batman, because when he does his entrance, he does do it with the cape.
Yeah.
You know, and
it was very reminiscent of the 89 Batman, like when he was standing, you know, kind of the silhouette. Yeah.
Right. The musical cues were there. It didn't really, the story itself didn't deviate into some unneeded subplot.
Yeah.
You know, it made, for the most part, made sense. I just did not like how it began, you know.
Yeah, that was like, yeah. I figured we'd gotten a little bit more than just a scene.
Yeah, like Two-Face happens because Harvey Dent gets splattered with everyone else's evil.
Yeah, but I feel like then that would have been like something underneath him the whole time if that's all it took for him to become evil incarnate, as he said.
Right.
It just, I kind of was expecting more, but.
I know, but you know what? You also got to remember that they have to play off of the 1960s era. And in the 1960s era, a lot of things happen. They're not explained fully. Or Batman just knows exactly what happened, how it happened. That's it.
Yeah.
No questions asked, you know?
That's just how he was back then, you know?
But I got to give it up to him. As much as I think that there is way too much Batman right now, Bats gets all the exposure, all the limelight. I gotta give it up for this movie.
It was nice to visit that era again. Like I saw the last one,
mm-hmm.
which was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
This one just as it was a very nice final
swan song
for Adam West. Like he goes out as his Batman on a very high note.
Yep.
You know?
Yep. So I have a question for you, cuz.
Sure.
Would you display this in your collection? Like your physical collection?
Proudly. Hell yes, I would.
Cuz we watched this on digital release.
We like literally just finished watching it like 20 minutes before we started this. Like it's still very fresh in our brains. Can we also talk about the whole Jekyll and Two-Face thing?
Yeah.
I want to talk
about that before we end this off. The way that they did Two-Face, as opposed to what we know him as, once Harvey and Two-Face collided, like Two-Face just took over.
Yeah.
In this case, he's fighting his inner demon.
To an extent, because like it didn't seem like he was fighting him that hard until we fought. Because for most of it, whenever you see Two-Face, they keep the normal half. In shadow. Like, even if there's no light, there's still that part in shadow for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
And then you don't really see it until the big reveal where he comes out and admits that, you know, he's one of the brighter villains. Actually, one of the brighter people in this whole universe, because he's the only one that really takes note that whenever Bruce Wayne's not around, Batman's there and vice versa.
Yeah.
Because there was that whole scene where, you know, he admitted that he knew it. And then he sent letters to most of the major villains in Gotham.
And then have them at an auction.
That Catwoman almost won till the Joker was like, let's pool our money together.
As bad as Catwoman is, she can't.
Catwoman.
She's not bad. She just.
Catwoman is very anti-hero.
Yeah, she's very anti-hero. Very anti-hero. And it shows very well in this,
especially in this one.
Mm-hmm. Like her loyalties are to no one.
Yeah.
She loves Batman. That's one thing. But her loyalty lies with no one.
Mm-hmm.
And it looked like she could have she could have switched sides had had they not been cock-blocked when they tried to kiss again. It was just, I'm just saying, they tried to kiss twice, and each time they were interrupted. So
bat-blocked. But yeah, back to more of the Two-Face thing of it all. Like, his, like, that's, like, it was just, it was a new take on it. Because you don't really, usually it's just, oh, he got his face burned. You know, that's why he's pretty much Two-Faced. But this one, it caused, like I said earlier, a Dr. and Jekyll Hyde, like, transformation situation. Because, right. Like, the whole time when you think, oh, Harvey Dent is, oh, he's cured. No, that's just something's going on where he can control the gross half of his face and make it look normal. And, the, like, Two-Face has been there the whole time, you know?
Right.
Nothing really changes. Somehow during whatever, that's a thing. And then there's that whole scene where they're fighting each other. Like, he's choking himself, essentially.
Right.
And then he becomes One-Face again, but the reverse One-Face.
Like, Two-Face completely takes over his entire body, clothes and all. Like, every time...
Yeah, that was weird. Like, like, for no reason, like, his, like, when he's... Before he becomes Two-Face again, when he's just regular, he's got this... What, cream-colored suit, whatever.
And then all of a sudden, it's purple.
Yeah, when the half Two-Face half comes out, like, suddenly, like, it changes his clothes. But, okay, once
same
again.
Same thing happened with Robin when he got captured.
When he was Robin-Face.
And they did the Two-Face thing on him. You got to see him act bad for a while, and you saw the Two-Face half, and his clothes changed, too. And I'm like...
So, it's something in the structure of the gas or whatever...
Yeah.
...that causes not only your face to change, but just half of your clothes.
Just half of your clothes.
Until, like I said, he becomes One-Face.
No stains or anything
and
then, like that.
Which was weird, because when he was One-Face, it was like... It was a mirror image, because it was like his mouth was still pointed in the middle, but it was just... That was how his face was.
And his lip would, like, curl up a little bit.
Yeah, on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, it was a mirror image, but... And then, that you know, the fight where... it brings back that point, too, when he was about nobody gets harmed in this.
Yeah.
Because when he's... After, you know, they're flying the plane and it crashes, just walks... Runs away unscathed.
Unscathed.
Just crashed.
No ripped clothes, nothing.
Crashed into the side of a building and just running away like, you'll never catch me, the bat. And
I thought they killed him, honestly. I thought they were going to...
No, they don't kill villains in this.
No.
In this universe. But it was... What was I... It's good for what it is.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I don't know what I'm trying to say right now.
I think you're a little tongue-tied because it was a fun movie.
It definitely was. It was fun as hell.
It was a very fun movie. It was the last time we'll probably hear.
No, it was the last time.
last time we'll hear Adam West, but he went out as Batman again.
Yeah. And he went out, like I said, he went out on a high note.
Everybody in there, and I got it. And I didn't even mention his name before, but the original Robin,
Burt Ward.
I gotta give it up for Burt Ward.
Like, it was nice to have the surviving cast members of that show come back and do it, because I feel like there's only the four left.
Yeah,
you know, like it's just. Well, three left now, but at the time of the recording, they were making this, there was only the four left, Batman, Robin, and the two Catwomen.
Yeah.
Surviving Catwomen.
But they both ended up in the movie.
Yeah, which was nice, because, I mean, I feel like they figured this was probably going to be the last time, which kind of sucks, because it would have been nice to see a animated 66 versions of other characters we haven't seen yet, like a Poison Ivy or a Killer Croc.
Or
maybe.
Killer Croc.
Hey, why the hell not?
Hey, we got Clock King. We got
who cares about? Nobody cares about Clock King.
He showed. Look.
Yeah,
but he showed up.
And
that's
so did
point.
Egghead.
So the Egghead had no lines of dialogue.
Well, because
or
I don't
anything.
Think anybody on that. Well, maybe somebody probably could have did a pretty decent Vincent Price. I could have probably did a pretty decent.
Even the Riddler had a few lines of dialogue, but the Riddler's a popular villain. So.
Yeah. Like the rest of them were just
filler.
Yeah, for the most part, because I mean, if you don't really know your Bat villains, you're not gonna know Clock King or Egghead or What was the third one? That other one.
Who? The cowboy.
Shane. No one's gonna know that. Like, they're only gonna know the ones that, you know, you see often in anything bat related.
Yeah, but they put just about all of them in Lego Batman.
Yeah, that was a beautiful thing. That was that whole movie.
Condiment King.
Look, that movie is easily my top. In my top three Bat movies of all time.
On screen? Heck yeah.
In general.
Heck yeah.
That movie was... It was a beautiful love letter to Batman. And just an awesome Batman movie in and of itself.
Yeah. And for those who want to know, yes, he does do the Batusi.
Oh, yeah. We were actually looking forward to that.
We were waiting to see.
In the credits.
Oh, my God. I'm choking right now.
In the credits, there's a scene where all the characters are doing, like, real 60s dances. And me and Kyle were sitting there. Like, we watched. The credits are only, what, like, 2 minutes? Not even that.
Yeah.
But every time they showed Batman, we're like, they can't not have this guy do the Bat.
Because at first, he was, like, uppercutting the air.
He was doing the Goldie Hawn socket to me thing from laughing. And we're like, come on, man. You got this 60s theme. Everybody's doing these 60s ass dances. You can't not have him not do the Batusi. And when we did it, we kind of like happy as shit.
But it was like one of those things that you blinking and miss it.
You gotta really watch the credits.
You really gotta watch the credits. Watch them the whole way through. Just for those dance moves.
Cause they were some smooth.
Just for the
some
nostalgia.
Animated moves.
If you are a Batman 60s fan, if you are a Batman fan in general, I don't care what version. Watch this movie. Enjoy it. It's family friendly. Yeah, it's family friendly. And you will not be disappointed. Like I said, the only real thing, you know, the only real things I had a problem with was all the things that you come to expect from that era anyway. So really, I shouldn't really have much of a problem with it. I'm just critical.
Well, we are reviewing it. I mean, there's not going to be you can't review something with no criticism.
Exactly. So enjoy the movie. I highly recommend it. Yeah. Just moment of silence for Adam West.
Yeah. For there we go.
And with that, we're gonna leave you with peace, love, and so, never be normal.
Oh, I keep forgetting you're gonna say never be normal. I think it's going to be Soul at the end.
Oh, man. Love you, Cousin Rick.
Back at you, bro.